We are the paradoxical ape. Bipedal, naked, large-brained, long the master of fire, tools, and language, but still trying to understand ourselves. Aware that death is inevitable, yet filled with optimism. We grow up slowly. We hand down knowledge. We empathize and deceive. We shape the future from our shared understanding of the past. CARTA brings together experts from diverse disciplines to exchange insights on who we are and how we got here. An exploration made possible by the generosity of humans like you.
Great, so thank you so much for being here. I'm a complex disease computational geneticist. So I study measures of inheritance, both observed factors like DNA sequence variants and also inferred factors comparing similarity in relatives. We do this using large healthcare and omics data with tools from computer science, mathematics, statistics, epidemiology. And my goal is really to better understand and predict common multi-cause conditions, things like major depressive disorder. I got my start looking at maps of the genome. So 2 decades ago, the genome was sequenced. And since then, one thing we've done is piled labels on that genome. So labels of things like brain expressed genes or regulatory elements, human accelerated regions of evolution, et cetera. And some of my earliest work was developing statistical tests that would ask if certain labels on the genome were relevant for complex traits. So that's kind of the perspective that I'm going to speak about today from this angle. And the work I'm going to present isn't my own, but I'll present it through this lens. This work was actually done here at UCSD. So I was a fellow, as Pascal mentioned, in this Anthropogeny program. So I have a really, it's really special for me to be here. Here's a picture of myself, one of our other speakers, Corinna, and Pascal about 10 years ago in the field in East Africa. And what happens when you put a computational geneticist in the field in East Africa is sometimes they exhibit what Pascal called highly suboptimal behavior. So if there's any primatologists in here, you can analyze if there's something interesting here. I think what's really interesting is we have two primate species emitting very high-pitched vocalizations that mirrored each other, but covering our mouths to let the other one know that this was not a threat response, right? So I don't know, but that's not really what we're here to talk about. When I told the fellows that I was coming back, they said I had to show the chimpanzee picture. So what we'll talk about is archaic genomic introgression, or old DNA, that stepped into the human lineage, right? So evolution needs variation. We have some genomes. The way that we often think about variation getting into a genome is through mutation. Some mutation happens, we change a letter, and then if that mutation is beneficial, it'll spread throughout the population. You can also have standing variation. We're 99% the same. There's DNA variability among us. If there's some environmental change and some of that becomes more important, that particular DNA may spread throughout the population as well. A really interesting and one that's gotten a lot of attention recently is this idea of introgression. So the idea here is there's some genomes, and at some point, one of those genomes mated with a kind of different genome, a cousin species or something, and that mating brought unique DNA into the lineage. And if that was special, that could also spread. And this is known in other species. For example, matings between sister species of mice has been associated with pesticide resistance, or matings between wolves and domesticated dogs is thought to be responsible for the black coat observed in some wolf species in the US. But a question is, what about us modern humans? How did archaic DNA step into our lineage? We've seen a few of these plots today showing human lineages, and here's one taken from a review paper. And an interesting thing about humans is, you know, we are derived from Homo erectus, which had already spread across Eurasia and evolved into different lineages. So here we show from the fossil record where Neanderthals were living, spread across Western Eurasia. And this was before Homo sapiens migrated out of Africa. At the time when Homo sapiens, modern Homo sapiens, migrated out of Africa, they encountered and replaced these Neanderthals and their Denisovan cousins. So here you see three parallel lines, which is just to show the three paralleling cousin species that were occupying different parts of the world. And when modern humans were expanding, they were coming into contact with and interbreeding these dying out Neanderthal and Denisovan lineages. This is kind of a map from 2022, which is showing there are multiple events of introgression with these different human lineages. So how do we know that archaic DNA stepped into our genome? We now have sequences of some of these archaic genomes. So we have examples of Neanderthal DNA that was taken from some of these archaeological fossil records and whole genome sequenced. And we have whole genome sequence on many, many individuals from the human population. And so we can do a comparison. You can ask if there is sequence in the modern human genome that is very, very similar to these archaic references. And this could be a really interesting way to find regions that may have come from these Neanderthal lineages. A mutation perhaps arose, here represented by the star, on this Neanderthal branch after it diverged from humans, changing an A to a T. And then with that mating, we observe that mutation now in the human lineage, assuming it came from the Neanderthal background. Simply matching can be complicated because this A mutation could have arisen before the split, and we could have had standing variation that was passed through both of these lineages, and we just haven't sequenced enough ancient DNA to have observed that polymorphism in this old sample. So we will use other types of information to ask if a given sequence that looks like archaic DNA is in fact archaic DNA. So something about human genomes. Here we have two chromosomes that are some founder chromosomes. With each generation, those chromosomes undergo recombination and they exchange information. So after one generation, the distribution of chromosomes in the population will look like a mix of these founding chromosomes. They'll also accumulate some mutations. Those mixed chromosomes will further mix, subdividing the sections of the original parent genomes, and over many, many generations, we'll find that we can compare the genomes of a population and identify these very small segments that'll be interspersed with some mutations. We may identify some genome segments that have unique features. They seem to be segregating in the human genome in a block that's too large for this demographic model. And they may have accumulated a unique set of mutations that's not also consistent with this simple model. And this can also be evidence that there was an introgression. A new genome came into the population, and it looks like it came in a time that doesn't fit the features of the rest of the genome sequence. We can also use hypotheses about human demographic history. Based on the fossil record, we believe that Neanderthals were living outside of Africa, and so these interbreeding events were happening after modern humans moved out of Africa. And if we observe these sequences similar to Neanderthal genome, specifically in populations outside of Africa, that can add a third piece of evidence. So a question might be, how much of our genome looks similar to archaic genomes? Is in interesting segments that match demographic expectations. And I take a small liberty when I say this because there's a wide variety of studies that combine these three lines of information with different ways. So a nice study done in Iceland identified 14 million fragments of DNA among 28,000 whole genomes. And they showed this distribution across the genome here. So here they're painting labels on the genome where the red and the blue dots are referring to regions of the genome where at least one segment was thought to have arisen in a Neanderthal. And what they showed is that in at least one person, they observed archaic DNA in 33 to 50, like a third to half of the genome. So there was a lot of this DNA covering the genome. But how much is in an individual? Here I take from a review paper from one of our other speakers who has looked at different estimates of this average total amount within individuals, and we end up with approximately 2% of any one individual's genome is made up of this archaic DNA. So a question is, what does this archaic DNA do? It seems to have flown, it stepped into our lineage, but is it functional? Does it make us human? In general, Neanderthal DNA probably did bad stuff. Models estimate that it originally made up about 10% of our genome, but was rapidly reduced down to this level of 2%. And here what we show is a map, similar thing, labels on the genome, where the black density curve is showing regions of the genome that have been observed more archaic fragments. And it varies a lot across the genome. It's generally observed at low frequency in regions of the genome that are known to have important biological functions. For example, genes expressed in the brain or in the testes. It's also at a lower frequency in regions that are specific to humans, so that have gone a lot of change on the human specific lineage. It's also on low frequency on the X chromosome. The X chromosome is thought to be especially sensitive to deleterious mutations. And it's also low in regions that are low from Denisovan introgression. So that's important because sometimes DNA just falls out of the genome due to drift, but if there's this convergence between these two different introgress sessions, then it must mean these deserts are maybe really important. So what we're seeing is there's a lot of this Neanderthal DNA, but it's kind of absent in some core important regions. You can also identify regions where there's very exceptionally low Neanderthal DNA called Neanderthal deserts, and these are marked by the colored bars on this genome map. And some of these regions contain especially important human genes, for example, this FOXP2 gene that's thought to be involved in language and vocalization. But despite this global kind of reduction of Neanderthal DNA, there are some specific examples where maybe these archaic DNA served us a good function. So one is in our immune system. There has been a lot of work showing that standing genetic variation in our HLA gene complex is critical for a robust immune system. And some of this was introgressed. So these HLA cassettes are sets of proteins that identify self on the outside of cells. And having diversity here is really important. So grabbing diversity from mutation is good. Taking advantage of standing variation is good. But this introgression, providing more diversity in this region, may also have been good. And here they're showing distributions of segments in this HLA region that show this characteristic pattern of being at a high frequency outside of Africa. There was another gene called STAT2, which also has shown to have a form that was introgressed from Neanderthals and seems to have undergone some positive selection in humans. This is one involved in viral response. And here again, you see these pie charts showing that this gene exists in an appreciable frequency, but really only outside of Africa, giving that kind of secondary piece of information that this may be an important introgressed region. There may also be some introgressed variants that are specific to variability in our skin and our hair. So this is showing two genes and looking at maps of whether there is evidence of introgressed Neanderthal genes. So the position of the genome is there linearly, and the red and blue lines are representing archaic segments that are thought to be introgressed from Neanderthals. And here they're shown specifically in just some populations. So there's an excess of Neanderthal DNA in the European population in this gene region and in the Asian population for this other gene region. So these modern human population specific Neanderthal introgression suggests there may be some adaptive response here, perhaps to climate in Europe and Asia. This is genes related to hair color, skin color, freckling. So what about complex traits? Things that I study. Are these Neanderthal variants really driving the presence of complex traits in humans? And I say they're contributors to men and drivers to none. What do I mean by that? We now, as I mentioned, we have these maps where we can paint genome-wide areas of the genome where archaic introgression has been observed. And we can also paint maps with areas of the genome that have been associated with complex traits and diseases. And what we can find is a few examples of individual variants that have been associated with a number of complex traits, things like height and sleep and heart rate, obesity, blood disorders, smoking, mood disorders. And many of these variants were also thought to have been introgressed. But these complex traits receive contributions from maybe 10,000 different variants. So if you look at a lot of genome labels and you go hunting for it, you can always find a couple variants that have a couple interesting unique signatures. But the question is, in aggregate, is this signature on the genome really the core driver of this trait variability? And some studies have tried to look at this. And what they've done is taken a more aggregated view. So they said, in aggregate, does variation in regions that have been introgressed differentially explain such complex traits? And what they're showing here is a measure of that. So relative to a random label on the genome, how important is variation within introgressed regions for all different kinds of complex traits? And this bar being shifting to the left here is saying that for essentially all complex traits, the variation that falls in these regions is less important than a random variant. There's some exceptions, and they're the ones you would think. It's sunburn, it's skin care, it's sun tanning. So these key examples that we saw before, those are maybe more important. Way down at the bottom was cognitive traits. So then, is this archaic introgression unique to humans among the great apes? There's actually some interesting recent studies that suggest there has been archaic admixture into bonobos and into eastern gorillas. Both of these are what they're called ghost introgression. So we talk about three different sources of information you'd like to see: alignment with an archaic genome, interesting features of genome segments, and then and distributions around known demographic models. So recent evidence suggests that there could be archaic introgression in these other great apes, but these are based on small samples, and critically, there's no archaic reference genomes. So we're leaning on one of the three pieces of evidence. There's also less archaeological record of archaic great apes outside of humans, and we have fewer phenotypic insights. So maybe it's a lower bound. It looks like there's maybe some evidence. There's some interesting genome segments that could potentially be introgressed, and it'd be really interesting to try to follow this up. So how special are our Neanderthal genes? Well, introgression is an interesting and important source of variation that's not necessarily unique to humans. It seems like a process across many different species. We have a lot of Neanderthal DNA, but we have much less than we used to, especially in functional and potentially key human-defining regions. It does seem to sprinkle variability into complex traits, meaning there's some variants that add a little bit of risk for complex disorders or contribute to height, but these don't seem to be the core drivers of these phenotypes. But it may have helped with a few key adaptations to local challenges, things like climate or pathogens. And I think that is what I think is pretty interesting here. So do Neanderthal genes cause our humanness in some way? I don't think so, but I think what's really interesting about the human species, and Pascal, others have touched on this, is this range of the globe that we operate in. So we have spread all over the globe into all different kinds of climates and environments and dealt all different kinds of adaptive challenges. So maybe it's rather our humanness that caused our Neanderthal genes, because we've gone out in these successive ways. So, yeah, thank you.